switch. We are children of the earth. From the calcium in our teeth, to the iron in our red blood cells, and to the copper needed to metabolize that iron, we are of the earth. We are not simply stewards of the earth. We are not simply protectors of the earth. We are the earth. Every cell, every tissue, every organ, every all. Our earth builds us. We are one and the same. What we do to her, we do to us. Many of us are also children of privilege. In my entire lifetime, the longest I have lived involuntarily without electricity is 36 hours. After a series of thunderstorms tore through northeastern Minnesota, pulling down power lines as they pulled down trees, plunging our home into complete darkness. I have lived a life of electrified privilege. I have never wondered even once if my electricity would be anything other than affordable and reliable. Our earth provided me that privilege. Fossil fuels have kept the lights on in my home, my schools, my workplaces, and everywhere in between. I have never pulled up to a gas station and hoped that there would be fuel for my gas tank. I have never wondered if there would be natural gas or propane available to keep me toasty warm during normally harsh winters. Even during that extended power outage, we were still able to meet the really key priorities in our life as we kicked up our gas-powered generator just long enough to brew coffee. That is privilege provided by our earth. Industrialization and fossil fuels have provided everything we have in our lives that we take for granted. And we are just now starting to understand that there is a cost to this progress and to this privilege. After centuries of industrialization that advanced society, advanced civilization, and dramatically improved the quality of life in many, but not all, areas of the globe, we are now starting to understand the consequences. As temperatures rise, as ice sheets melt, and as unpredictability is all that remains predictable, we can no longer ignore that climate change is here, and that we have to figure out a solution moving forward that also protects our Earth. For generations, we have relied on others to keep us in comfort and privilege. We have relied on coal miners. We have relied on roughnecks in oil fields. We have relied on workers in power plants and refineries to keep us in blissful ignorance. We have relied on people who operate grids to shuffle power transmission around so that we never experience even the slightest hiccup in our lives. That is privilege. As we transition away from this fossil fuel-based system to a minerals-dependent system of clean energy, we are finally waking up to the fact that our lives have a consequence. Clean energy is minerals-dependent energy. From capturing the energy, to storing the energy, to transmitting that energy, every step requires metals. According to the World Bank, a 3-megawatt windmill requires 4.7 tons of copper and 335 tons of steel in its construction. In 2021, the Minnesota Department of Commerce estimated that 21% of Minnesota's energy came from wind energy, with a total capacity around 4,600 megawatts. This means that that energy translated into 14 million pounds of copper just in energy capture alone. One-fifth of one state's energy needs required 14 million pounds of copper. The question is, how are we going to keep providing for this way of life that we're used to if this way of life requires using our earth? One thing we need to start talking about is conservation. We don't talk often enough about it. We don't ask people to limit their consumption. We don't ask people to limit their demands. Energy and efficiency and conservation are underutilized and undervalued tools in protecting our earth. If we limit our demands, we can limit our impact. The other thing we don't do well and that we don't talk enough about is recycling. When you look at what it takes to get these minerals out of the ground, when you look at the manpower involved in bringing these minerals up from the ground, when you look at the energy required to bring these minerals up from the ground, we have to make sure those minerals never go back into the ground. Climate change is a global problem that requires local solutions. While our goals for the nation are set in places like Paris and the Paris Agreement, or in Dubai at the United Nations Climate Change Conference, the actual realization of those goals occurs in places like this, and it requires boots on the ground. And it requires conversations between different parties of people who are coming to the table with diverse feelings on things, different perspectives, and sometimes they're in conflict with one another. Because our energy matters. Our privilege matters. Our energy security matters. We wake up every morning assuming our day will go as planned. We trust that our cities will be lit up, that streetlights will be shining down upon us, and that traffic lights will be keeping some of you in check. Not me, I'm good. We assume our computers will be powered up, our factories humming, and our creature comforts will be available to us with the push of a power button. We want to maintain that privilege. But how do we maintain that privilege while protecting our earth? In January 2024, NPR did a story, and it talked about where these energy transition metals are located. They stated that 54% of energy transition metals globally are found on or near the lands of indigenous peoples. In the U.S. alone, 97% of our nickel and 89% of our copper is found within 35 miles of Native American reservations. Nickel and copper. That's our story here in Minnesota, and it's our story here in northeastern Minnesota, home, ancestral, and current home of the Ojibwe people. I am not Native American. However, I respect that if we're going to talk about a fair and just energy transition that requires those metals to provide for our quality of life, those voices have to be heard. Those are critical voices that contribute to this conversation, that lead this conversation. Within this climate crisis, is an opportunity for healing. So why Minnesota? Like I said, nickel and copper, that's our story. But really, Minnesota's ability to contribute to climate change solutions from the ground up began 2.2 billion years ago. The great oxidation event led to our iron ore resources, led to our manganese resources. And we've been mining those iron resources since the 1880s, and mining continues today. When a 3-megawatt windmill requires 335 tons of steel, we have to talk about the sourcing of it. Our non-iron resources came into being 1.1 billion years ago, which geologically is a day apart. And those non-iron resources came about because our continent tried to tear itself apart. And magma came up from the mantle up into the crust, and that in that magma came the copper, the nickel, the platinum, palladium, gold, cobalt, silver, titanium, and vanadium, all the metals needed for the energy transition. When a 3-megawatt windmill requires 4.7 tons of copper, we have to talk about the source of it. We have to talk about Minnesota, and we have to talk about mining. But we must also talk about water. Minnesota's a land of 10,000 lakes. We have more shoreline than Hawaii, Florida, and California combined. Minnesotans value our water resources. And just like our mineral resources, we have our geological history to thank for them too. Much more recently, only 1.2 million years ago, glaciers began to advance and retreat into Minnesota, with the final retreat only 11,000 years ago. And with those advances and retreats, it's the scoured bedrock, they deposited sediment in some areas, and they shaped our landscape as we know and love it, filled with lakes, rivers, and wetlands. Minnesotans, more than anyone, are positioned to lead the conversation about climate change solutions. We have four biomes, and the boundaries of those biomes all are predicted to rise and go northward as our climate changes. We've already seen the threat of invasive species such as the emerald ash borer that threaten to decimate our beloved forests. Our water resources are expected to feel stress as our ice-covered seasons shorten, as our temperatures rise, and as our population increases due to the recognition of this area as a climate refuge. Minnesota has also already committed to 100% clean energy by 2040, making us a leader in the nation, but also making us one of the greatest demands for the minerals needed to build out that infrastructure. And finally, Minnesota has the mineral resources to talk about. Extracting those mineral resources is not without risk. And it is not without valid concerns about the air, water, and the land. The air that we breathe, the water that we drink, and the land that nourishes us. As consumers of the energy that powers our lives, heats our homes, and gets us from point A to point B, we should feel this friction. And we should understand that clean energy and the solution for climate change requires using our earth to provide the metals needed to protect her. This should feel uncomfortable. These decisions that we will make on extracting these minerals come from conversations. Conversations that are really difficult. Conversations about indigenous rights. Conversations about our consumerism and our privilege. Conversations about national security and energy security and environmental protection, environmental regulations and environmental science and environmental engineering. And conversations about how we maintain that privilege we have had and extend it to others. Conversations about how we respect the earth while also asking her to provide for us. Conversations about mining. Minnesotans are positioned to lead climate change solutions from the ground up, together. But first, We need to have a conversation. Thank you.